Let's talk about granny flats and dual occupancies, because the way that council currently treats them is insane. A dual occupancy is just a fancy way of saying that there are two houses on the same block of land, but under one title, one owner. It's not like a subdivision, because there's no rezoning, there's no sale, there's no separation of the ownership of the land. Now, there are two kinds of dual occupancies. Detached, where there's two full separated houses on the same block, and attached, where the two dwellings are connected in some way, like a duplex. I live in an attached dual occupancy here at Oakville with my family, where we have two houses which are connected by a covered walkway. Here's the crazy thing. In our council, detached dual occupancies are forbidden because of, wait for it, flood evacuation risks. And that's regardless of whether you're in Bilpin or Oakville. But put that covered walkway in and everything's peachy, totally fine, permitted. Detached dual occupancies are already permitted with constraints in many other councils like Hills, Cumberland, Parramatta and Northern Beaches. But it gets worse. People often get confused between dual occupancies and what are called secondary dwellings. Secondary dwellings are much smaller, only up to 60 square metres. That's little more than one or two rooms, and they've got to be close to the primary dwelling. It's what you and I would call granny flats. Now, if you want to build a granny flat in, say, Bligh Park or Hobartville or any of these residential zonings on a block that's usually under 800 square metres, apparently that's fine. But if you live elsewhere on one of these zonings, that maybe you have 5 acres, 25 times the size of a house block in Bligh Park, the answer is no, you can't. It's not allowed. And this makes no sense at all. During this term of council, I have been the strongest advocate for reform of these rules, but I've been stymied by a lack of support amongst the other councillors. I'm seeking your support to continue this work through your vote at the upcoming election. Now, let me try and explain why this is important. For a balanced community, the Hawkesbury needs a mix of housing types. I've argued that dual occupancies confer a range of social benefits. Your ability to put another dwelling on the land that you own could allow you as parents to give a leg up to your kids, to build a home, or to get equity in the market, or to continue to live in the communities where they grew up, or to enable grandparents to care for their grandkids. And on the flip side, it might allow you to look after your parents in their senior years with a degree of dignity and independence, but still close to the ones that they love, sharing the burdens of property maintenance or the cost of living. That is the way that my family live. We exemplify this. I live in a multi-generational household with toddlers, teens, adults, seniors, spaniels and cats living together in joyous chaos. I've heard this described as a very European way of living. It's not for everyone, but for many families it makes a lot of sense. For some, it's an economic necessity, but ultimately it's about choice. Your choice. Studies show that 1 in 5 households are multi-generational in New South Wales, and that figure is growing, and 40% of people in their 20s are still living at home. To me, this is an example of how something obscure, good planning laws, can strengthen communities by empowering councils to plan for diversified housing choices with far less impact on existing services and infrastructure than full-blown subdivision. Other people support secondary dwellings because it represents a form of affordable housing, which we badly need more of. And lastly, we cannot ignore the fact that many acreage areas can and will be subjected to development pressure. Now, I am no fan of overdevelopment. Dual occupancies may represent a kind of happy compromise between the status quo and the wholesale rezoning and carve-up that developers want to foist on us. Many people I speak to want a sensible solution like this, but I challenge you to find another councillor that has made any public statement in favour of this idea. And you and I probably already know somebody in the Hawkesbury with a clandestine granny flat that's offending nobody but is against the rules. In February this year, Hillshire Council, next door, took advantage of a recent change to state rules, something called the LEP standard instrument, to apply for and get a more generous definition of granny flats. As a result, Hills landowners can now build granny flats that are still modest but larger than before, whichever is the larger of 110 square metres or 20% of the size of the main dwelling, up from 60 square metres. I'd like our council to consult and to consider doing the same, using a place-based approach that's sensitive to all the factors and constraints like land fragmentation, loss of agricultural capacity, emergency evacuation, local roads and infrastructure, and the protection of the environment. As I've said, I have tried to drive reform in this area, but it's been really hard. Our best hope is the detailed work that Council and I have done this year in revamping our LEP and DCP, our two fundamental planning codes. But progress has been really painful and really slow. I've pushed for these proposals to be put into the new codes for public comment, but it will be the next council that signs them off. I'd love to know what your views are on this subject. What do you think? And please consider carefully who you will support at the upcoming council elections. Thanks for watching.